I would just like to say Mark Cusano retiring is a sad day for our industry. He is and was one of the most informative people that we had and supported this great game that we all love. And I could tell you this, I started my first horse 25 years ago when Mark was first started as far as narrating and asking questions. And Mark is much appreciated in our business. He could reach out to the best, the Chad Browns, the Bob Baffords, the Todd Pletchers. Everyone loved being on his show. He was informative. He's going to be missed. And I have to say this from the bottom of my heart. The one day that he interviewed me when I had my grandson in Albany Med, and I was running a horse in a grade one up at Saratoga, the only thing Mark cared about was how my grandson was doing. And he said to me at that interview, he says, I will always pray for you and your grandson, and my grandson is doing great. Mark, we'll miss you. We love you. This industry will miss you. Thank you.
This is the OTB Television Network, a service of Capital District Off-Track Betting.
Mike Smith lets the ball roll. He's in front by five as they come to the quarter pole. But there is cause for concern. Concern comes on. Second on the outside. Tabasco Cat is well behind in third. They're coming down to the final furlong. Mike Smith asking Holy Bull for everything he has. Concern is coming hard under Jerry Belly. It's still Holy Bull desperately trying to hold. Concern a final thrust, but it is Holy Bull as game as a racehorse can be coming down to the wire. Holy Bull wins!
I'm Mark Cusano. On this morning's final show, a recap of a quarter of a century over the next 2 hours. We'll talk about some of the guests who have joined us through the years. We'll show you clips of certain interviews, timely, relevant interviews that we had. I'll be joined by a trio of in-studio guests, beginning with my co-host over the first 19 years, Mr. Michael Veach. Then Julie Hoxie, our associate producer for the past 23 years, will join us, talk about some of the guests, and she will tell you who said, which guest said, I'd rather go to the dentist than do these types of interviews. And it might surprise you who that guest was. John Nesignor, Capital OTB president, will also join us. We'll have a salute to all the folks who worked on Down the Stretch through the years. And to complete things, well, the interview of more than 2,000 which I've done, which still brings a big smile to my face. So all of that and a little bit more if you stay with us for this, our November 18th edition of the program, which is being sponsored by Bloodlines Racing, who in just a few short years has enjoyed tremendous success with New York bred turf champion Invading Humor, as well as her full sister Distorted Beauty. For information on their current partnerships, you can visit them on the web at bloodlinesracing.com, or better yet, give Randy McGlynn a call at area code 802-436-2159. Good morning once again on a rather chilly November Saturday. Pleased that you could join us for our final show. Well, we have done about 1,200 shows and probably approximately 2,500 interviews, and we're going to try to recap all of that this morning. Back in the early 1990s, Paul Vandenberg did a show on the network called The Morning Line Saturday Edition. And Mike Veach and I were regular guests on that program. Well, when Paul left to seek his fame and great fortune, I hope you're watching this morning, Paul, in radio, management asked me if I would like to take over the show. And I told them that I would. I'd like to tweak it a little bit. We kept our audience call-in segment. I wanted to add more of a topical discussion, but I wanted the show to be based on interviews with the biggest names in the sport, the most relevant people in the sport. And that would, for the most part, be trainers. Now, it's one thing to set a goal of that, but if you don't get cooperation from the folks you want to bring in, it's not going to work. And we were so very fortunate through that quarter of a century to get tremendous cooperation from our guests. So we got it all kicked off on Saturday, March 7th, 1992, down the stretch with Mark Cusano and Mike Veach debuted. And later that afternoon in Southern California, Best Pal went out and captured the Santa Anita handicap. It just doesn't seem like it was 25 and a half years ago. During that very first year, we had the great opportunity to interview a trio of future Hall of Famers about their future Hall of Fame runners. Neil Drysdale joined us to discuss AP Indy, who would go on to capture the 1992 Breeders' Cup Classic and be named champion three-year-old as well as Horse of the Year. Ron McAnally came on to discuss his Argentine import, Passayana, who won the 92 Breeders' Cup Distaff at Gulfstream from what I recall was a terribly difficult post and was named champion older mare. And Shug McGahee, who would become a mainstay on this program, joined us to discuss Lure, who won the 92 Breeders' Cup Mile and remains to this day the only horse in Breeders' Cup history to win the mile in wire-to-wire fashion. Sadly, Lure passed away on Wednesday at the age of 28. Now, I don't personally like politics, and we never made it a regular feature of discussion on the program. Although, during those very turbulent times between the New York Racing Association and the state of New York, when the franchise was up for renewal and racing was in the crosshairs, we discussed politics on a regular basis. And I remember one morning Michael and I having discussed those issues, and I went home. And the first thing my wife said to me when I walked through the door was, "You're not going to believe who called." I said, "Who was that?" Then Governor Mario Cuomo called wanting to speak to me. And of course, I asked my wife if she had gotten a phone number, but she said she was too shocked to remember to get one. So of course, I tried to call the governor. Nobody would put me through to him, and unfortunately never got a chance to talk with the late governor. Former New York State Attorney General Elliot Spitzer did an interview on the telephone. And he had a number of his advisors on another line. And I will absolutely never forget this. In fact, I remember it like it happened 5 minutes ago. I asked him the then billion-dollar question, who owns the land which Saratoga, Belmont, and Aqueduct sit on? The state or NYRA? And there was dead air. There was a lengthy silence. Before he answered, "I don't know, but I'm going to find out." And at the height of the battle for the franchise, we had then NYRA President Charlie Hayward and Senate Majority Leader Joe Bruno on. Now, that was not an easy interview for me to do, as I say, because, you know, politics is not my strength, but it happened to be a very necessary one at the time. Now, in addition to Charlie Hayward, We had all the other NYRA presidents dating back to the beginning of the show. Jerry McEwen, shown here with the late Penny Chenery. Kenny Noe, the old school racing man. Terry Meeks. And the interview I remember most with Terry had absolutely nothing to do with racing. It came shortly after the 9/11 tragedy, and we discussed what NYRA was doing at Belmont and Aqueduct to help out with that awful situation. And finally, current president Chris Kay. And the fourth interview I did with Mr. Kay at Saratoga, I believe it was 3 years ago, a NYRA executive filed a complaint against me for the way I handled that interview. Only complaint I ever got in 25 and a half years. Now, fortunately for me, when Capital Management reviewed the tape of the interview, they found that I handled it professionally. Since then, I've never asked another NYRA official to appear on the show. The mid to late 1990s featured several interviews with Billy Mott, and the subject being the Great Cigar, who was Horse of the Year in both 95 and 96. From the West Coast, we enjoyed interviewing Laura Desereau, often because she was training the magnificent Azeri, the champion older male of 2002, 2003, and 2004, and the Horse of the Year in 2002. Now, success at the very highest levels for local owners is much more prevalent now than it was in the early years of the show. Donnie Lucarelli, the Schenectady native, Mount Pleasant High School and Siena College graduate, and the co-managing partner for Starlight Racing, enjoyed much success, particularly with champion two-year-old Shanghai Bobby. And Ed Stanko, another Schenectady native and, like myself, a Linton High School graduate, joined us as his Princess of Sylmar was having a remarkable 2013 campaign, which included prestigious victories in the Kentucky Oaks, the Coaching Club American Oaks, the Alabama, and the Beldame, the latter versus the great Royal Delta. And then Roddy Valente of Loudonville. He stopped in to discuss his terrific, undefeated sprinter, Bustin Stones, 6-for-6, and the winner of the Grade 1 Carter. But the biggest local success story came in 2003 when Funnyside captured the Kentucky Derby and the Preakness. The New York-bred son of Distorted Humor caused a sensation, not only here locally, but literally worldwide. Now, it was just a week or two before the Kentucky Derby where we welcomed in Jack Knowlton, who was the managing partner of Saratoga Stable. It was Jack's first ever television interview. Let's take a look at a piece. We have got a very special in-studio guest this morning. I know a lot of you have been following the exploits of Funnyside, that absolutely sensational New York bred who was third, placed second in the Louisiana Derby, as well as finishing a close second behind Empire Maker in the Wood. And our special guest this morning is the managing partner of Saratoga Stable, the owner of Funnyside, Mr. Jack Knowlton. Jack, welcome to Down the Stretch.
Thank you very much, Mark. It's a pleasure to be here.
Well, thanks so much for taking time out of your schedule to join us. Jack, there's a lot of people in this area very, very excited about Funnyside. First of all, tell the audience a little bit about yourself, if you would.
Well, I'm a healthcare consultant, have a small firm in Saratoga Springs. Been involved in horse racing back to the early 80s, was involved in standardbreds for about 12 years. And in 1995, with five of my old high school friends, we decided to pool some money, $5,000 a piece, and bought a thoroughbred. And Funnyside is the ninth thoroughbred that we've had.
Saratoga Stable. Kind of an interesting name. Where did that come from?
Our hometown and my five partners, four of whom still live there, Sackett's Harbor, and of course I live in Saratoga, so we combined the two, and that's how Saratoga came to be.
Where's Sackett's Harbor?
It's right at the eastern end of Lake Ontario, about 8 miles from Watertown.
So my partner would, of course,
I didn't have to ask.
Yes, no, he didn't have to ask. I did. Jack, let's take a look at the partners involved in Saratoga Stables and involved in Funnyside. And why don't you talk us through this, because we've got some nice local connections, and there's the four fellas still in Sackett's Harbor, 10 of you involved in Funnyside.
That's correct. Gus Williams is from Delmar. Gus has been involved in all of the horses after our initial horse. Dave Mann from Watertown, Connecticut. Dave is a player that has been staying in Saratoga for all of the meets for a number of years and is continuing to be part of our partnership. Lou Titterton is one of our good friends from Saratoga. He's in the healthcare business. Lou was involved in one of the harness horses with me and has been involved in most of the thoroughbreds that we have. Eric Datner is a partner from Long Island that was introduced to us by Barkley Tagg, who was our trainer. And Barkley has, been very instrumental in our success, and we've really enjoyed having Eric involved in our last four horses. Then my old high school classmates, John Constance, Harold Kring, Mark Phillips, Peter Phillips, and Larry Reinhardt, have all been involved from the beginning. They've participated in most of the horses, continue to follow Funnyside. 9 of the 10 partners will be going to Louisville. We had 7 of the partners down to New Orleans for the Louisiana Derby. 7 were at the Wood. And this is a group, there's a lot of camaraderie. We're having a lot of fun and really enjoying ourselves.
Speaking of the Wood, let's take a look at him heading down the backstretch. And he's sitting in second right now, very comfortably, with Empire Maker third on his flank. I mean, Jack, winning the Bongard is one thing. This is the Wood Memorial, one of the most historic races ever run in New York. You're running against the Derby favorite, and you run so well in here. What did this mean to you and the rest of the partners of Saratoga Stable?
Well, this punched our ticket to the Derby. Barkley, I think, as you probably have read throughout, even though in 30 years of training he's never had a Derby horse, he was not going to let this horse, unless we just really fought him right to the end, wasn't going to let this horse go to Louisville unless he felt he had a chance to win. He always is looking out for the best interests of the horse. He would like to see this horse, as we would, hopefully run at a high level for a few years, and given the fact that he's a gelding, we would anticipate that will happen. So that was really the Wood. We had felt coming out of the Holy Bull that, he was a legitimate racehorse. It was a terrible post, a terrible trip. That gave us enough confidence to decide, let's go to Louisiana. Let's try the Louisiana Derby, which we did. Again, I think that he validated the fact that he is a good racehorse, that he can run with the best of the crop. And then Barkley had always had the Wood as his number one choice of races. Everything really backed up from there in terms of setting the schedule.
So prior to Funnyside winning the Kentucky Derby, Jack Knowlton did, I think he did, 15 or 20 minutes with us that morning. The next major live interview he did after Funnyside won the Derby was 7 minutes with Katie Couric on the Today Show. Think they moved up in class quite dramatically. What Funnyside did, in my opinion, was draw incredible interest into partnerships, particularly locally. I mean, so many folks wanted to get involved in racing in their own little groups that I think Funnyside was the catalyst for that. That was a fantastic local story. On the very first show, on a dreary, cold, probably snowy January morning in 2004, we interviewed a little-known trainer about a little-known horse. Well, little-known at the time. The trainer was John Service, and his horse was Smarty Jones. And they would win, later that afternoon at Aqueduct, the Count Fleet Stakes. Then would go on to bigger and better things by capturing the Kentucky Derby and Preakness before coming up just short in a bid for immortality in the Belmont Stakes. During the marvelous career of Rachel Alexandra, the forgotten man in the saga joined us several times. That was her original trainer, Hal Wiggins. He had never had a big horse in his career, and now he had his once-in-a-lifetime great. Coming off surgery as a two-year-old, Rachel caught my eye when she impressively won the Golden Rod late in her freshman season at Churchill. That was the first of five consecutive wins for Wiggins and Rachel, culminating with her absolutely sensational victory by 20 and a quarter lengths in the Kentucky Oaks just before she was sold. Had they gone around again in the Oaks, she would have lapped them. And the man who rode Rachel throughout most of her career, Calvin Burrell, joined us several times. Not only did Calvin enjoy great success with Rachel, but his three Kentucky Derby wins in just a four-year period vaulted him into racing's Hall of Fame. It also led him to meet and dine with Queen Elizabeth II of England. And we talked to Calvin about that. Calvin and the Queen. I mean, is this a great country or what? That was just fabulous. You know, Saturday mornings were somewhat tricky as far as getting jockeys on. But in addition to Calvin, we had Hall of Famers like Johnny Velasquez and Ramon Dominguez. And we also had a trio of Hall of Famers join us. Mike Smith, who has ridden an abundance of great and outstanding horses, joined us to discuss, and this is just among others, Lure, Azari, Zenyatta, Royal Delta, Skipaway, Shared Belief, Songbird, Arrowgate. The list just goes on and on and on. And Mike was nice enough to join us each of the past 2 years at Saratoga. One of the most enjoyable jockey interviews I've ever done was with Pat Day years ago at the Spa. Now, that summer, we didn't use a desk. We didn't sit in front of a desk. We sat in chairs with a very small monitor on the ground in front of us. And when Pat's interview was over, we showed Summer Squall winning the 1989 Hopeful in the break. You know, we use breaks to get that guest off and the next one on. But instead of leaving, Pat Day got down on his hands and knees with his suit on the ground in front of the monitor, and gave us a detailed account of how Summer Squall had won that race. That was absolutely priceless. It's also priceless to win the Triple Crown. And that's what Victor Espinoza did aboard American Pharoah in 2015. Now, Victor had a near miss a year earlier aboard California Chrome, and he had joined us several times over those two very special years. Now, during that same two-year period, we had the pleasure of interviewing a trio of gentlemen who lived and breathed the Triple Crown. Ron Turcotte, shown here with Secretariat's trainer Lucian Lauren, talked about what it was like to ride Big Red and how very special winning the Triple Crown was for him. Steve Cawthon, who in 1978 became the youngest rider to win the Triple Crown while aboard Affirmed, gave us an interesting perspective of just what it takes from a jock standpoint to ride the mile and a half of the Belmont while under the most intense pressure of your life. And Billy Turner, who did such a great job guiding Seattle SLU to the Triple Crown in 1977, talked about keeping a horse as fresh as possible over that grueling 5-week period. Now, on Travers Day 2015, Bob Baffert joined us live at Saratoga for a good 35 minutes. We were obviously talking about American Pharoah for not only that day's Travers, but maybe more importantly, a look back at American Pharoah, the Belmont, and what that meant to Bob Baffert after he had gone through a couple of near misses. Let's take a look at a piece of that interview. And I would like to have you take us through what your thoughts are as the race unfolds, American Pharoah in front bidding for immortality. What's going through your mind?
Well, here I was, I was talking to Bodie, my son, and I told him around the first turn he looked really well. And right here, when I saw him turning for home, I said, he's loaded. And you can tell by Victor, when he's sitting on a horse, you can tell his body language. I didn't want to see what I saw in the Kentucky Derby. Yeah. 2.5, he's scrubbing. We don't want to see, if we see scrubbing and whipping, that means he's not running. So right here, when I saw him just sitting on him, he hadn't turned him loose yet. And I'm thinking, well, what is Frosted? Is the only horse that would probably give him a run. And for an instant there, I'm watching Frosted like he's trying to make a run. And I could see, then he let him out a notch. And from here on, I just listened to the crowd. I thought, it's finally going to happen. And it was just so emotional. I could hear my wife crying, and everybody was crying and happy and joyous. You know, it's just, you know, what a horse.
And here's a shot of you and your wife embracing. Can you tell us what she said to you?
She said, we're just, you know, she was crying, and she was, you know, we just said, you know, we did it, you know, finally, and you we're just soaking it in.
You've seen what American Pharoah has meant to the public. What's American Pharoah meant to Bob Baffert?
I think he was the cherry on top of my, my mother always told me I was going to win the Triple Crown, and I told her, I don't think so. We've had so many chances. I didn't think I'll get another chance. So to have a fourth chance, that was pretty incredible. So I think he's my, I don't want to say he's the swan song or whatever, but I'm hoping I'd get some more. I'm always looking forward to getting another one like that, but we're not giving it. I'd like to do it again because it's been a lot of fun.
Bob got a little emotional that day talking about his mom and dad. That was a very enjoyable interview to do. Mechanicville native Chad Brown hasn't won a Triple Crown yet, but his rise to the very top of the sport has been rapid and unlike anything I've ever witnessed. The first time we had Chad on the show was when he was an assistant to the late, great Bobby Frankel. Shortly after Chad went out on his own, and because of what I was witnessing, I stated on this show that I believed one day Chad would become a Hall of Famer. Now, I didn't say it because he was from our area. I truly believed it. Now, just a few years later, I'm absolutely convinced he'll have a plaque one day. The only time in the 25 years we've been on the air where I completely lost it was one summer at Saratoga. And the culprit was Tom Durkin. We were discussing his very early years calling races from, you know, unusual spots at various county fairs and such. And he started to relate a story about the time he got hustled off the stage while he was, you know, calling a race. They needed to get the band up on stage. They needed to get the accordionist set up. Well, that accordionist happened to be Myron Florin, who is best known for appearing on the Lawrence Welk Show. And the way Tom was telling the story, I could not stop laughing. I was actually having trouble breathing. And the thought crossed my mind, sitting there on a lovely, warm Saratoga August morning, that I might die right there on the spot. I had no idea how I was going to finish that interview. So the only time I've completely lost it, care of Mr. Durkin. Finally, the one who got away, the one guest who I desperately wanted him on the show, and we could never get him, Jess Jackson. I wanted him on the show because I felt very strongly that his purchase of Rachel Alexandra changed history. Rachel's former owner had emphatically stated that he would never run her versus males. So I have always felt that Jess Jackson's purchase of Rachel gave us those unforgettable moments and memories of her winning the Preakness, the Haskell, and the Woodward. The latter producing one of the most special days I have ever seen at Saratoga. We thought we had him for Woodward Day 2009 at Saratoga, but his wife called Julie and said, we've got a celebration to attend that morning. And if I remember correctly, it was a birthday celebration. Well, I told Julie to please tell them that we'd bake a cake or we'd have a, you know, breakfast buffet or whatever they needed. Just come on the show for a couple of minutes. And that's the one who got away, the late Jess Jackson. But as racing fans, we all owe Mr. Jackson a debt of gratitude because, folks, I am convinced if he hadn't bought Rachel when he did, we wouldn't have had those incredibly special moments with the Preakness and the Woodward. They were just fabulous. So there's a little bit of a recap. You know, obviously, you can't recap a quarter of a century in 30 minutes. It's just not possible. How about the two-year stretch Pat Byrne had? 1997, favorite trick, Countess Diana. Just unbelievable. Next year, awesome again. You know, in all the interviews we did with Kieran McLaughlin and Jimmy Toner and, you know, Al Stahl and so many of the New York guys and Jerry Hollendorfer and, you know, the guys out west treated us so well. So there's our opening segment. A look back at our 25 years, and we are up to our first break. When we return, I've really been looking forward to this. My co-host over the first 19 years of the program, Mike Veach, will join us as we go to this break. I've been going to Saratoga for better than 50 years, the last 35 as a journalist. I don't remember many days with more anticipation, more excitement, even in the press box. I mean, there was a feel of electricity as Rachel was trying to accomplish history. The first three-year-old filly to ever defeat older males in the 2009 Woodward. So we will take a look at that going to the break. The 2009 Woodward, back with Mike Veach right after these messages.
Well, Mark, I have to say I've enjoyed our time together. I'm disappointed and saddened that, you know, we're not going to be doing this anymore together. And I just would like to thank you for all your hard work and everything you've done for horse racing. And it's truly appreciated. And you'll be missed.
And they're off. Past the point on the outside. The Terra down toward the rail. Rachel Alexandra is right up there with them. and Cool Coleman on the outside. So they race into the first turn here. Rachel Alexander will duel with Datera. On the far outside, past the point is right there, and in behind Cool Coleman. A break of three, back to It's a Bird, another three. Back to Bulls Bay, who's on hold early on here. Asiatic Boy, and another seven to Macho again, who trails the field. Oh, the first quarter was 22 and 4/5 seconds. There'll be no free ride for Rachel Alexandra. They're making her work for every step today. Datera has sent her through a punishing opening quarter mile. Past the point on the outside, runs along in third. In behind them, Cool Coleman is fourth. It's a Bird fifth on the outside in Bulls Bay. 46 and 2 is a half mile. Calvin Morrell was able to slow that pace down just a little bit, but they move into the far turn. There's a half mile to go. Rachel Alexandra still holding that lead. Past the point, trying to get to her. The lead is now a length. On the inside, it is Cool Coleman running in third. It's a Bird is fourth. Asiatic Boy is launching a bit from the back of the pack. And Macho again is firing too. They're coming to the top of the stretch. It is still the filly in front. A dramatic stretch drive awaits in the Woodward Stakes. On the outside, here's Bulls Bay. And Calvin Morrell imploring his filly for more. And Rachel Alexandra holds on to the lead. Bulls Bay is second. Macho again is making a tremendous run for the back of the pack. Rachel Alexandra, Macho again. They're coming down to the finish. It's going to be desperately close. Here's the wire. Rachel won. She is indeed Rachel Alexandra, the great, beating Macho again here. And Father Beck, Bulls Bay was third. The time was 1:48:01. Rachel Alexandra raises the rafters here at the spa.
This is the OTB Television Network, a service of Capital District Off-Track Betting.
Champions don't come easy. It takes hard work, intelligence, and a desire to be the very best. At Bloodlines Racing, we team up with champion racehorses like Invasor, Street Cry, and others. Our second partnership horse, Invading Humor, became a champion turf filly in 2015. We want you to join our team. At Bloodlines Racing, we make ownership easy, utilizing a one-time only payment structure. You pay once, and that's it. We currently are making available three outstanding two-year-olds, one of them a sibling to champion Invading Humor. Come join us in the pursuit of our...
In a recent study of some of the top online wagering sites, Capital OTB won big in total player rewards, far surpassing some of the best-known wagering sites in America. While other rewards programs simply offer you points redeemable for gift cards, Capital OTB's rebates are paid to you in actual cash. Plus, Capital OTB gives you full and immediate access to your money. So if all you're getting now are points and gift cards, join Capital OTB Player Rewards today and get cash back. Visit CapitalOTBBet.com and sign up today.
Welcome back to Down the Stretch, everyone. Mike Veach to my left. I'm Mark Cusano. Back to Down the Stretch. My co-host over the first 19 years, my friend, Mr. Michael Veach. Good morning.
Good morning, Mark.
How are you?
Well, thank
it's
you
good
for
to see
thank you.
You
for inviting me in.
Who are those young guys on that?
I have no idea.
Oh,
I really
Lord.
Have no idea. But
you know,
thank you for what you've done for racing, and I'd like to add my voice to Roddy Valente's. I couldn't have said it any better than Roddy did. So you deserve this.
It's nice to see you.
You know,
it's been six
it's
and a half years. How you doing?
I'm doing really good. I'm doing really good.
Still doing the column for the Saratogian.
Still doing the Saratogian and working on book number three. You know, I have a trilogy of the Saratoga seasons up
That's
to
fantastic.
2008. And then we're going to be working on 150th anniversary of the Travers in a while, collaborating with the museum. We're going to put a coffee table book for the Travers.
That's wonderful.
2019 is the 150th. So
okay.
I got a lot of stuff on the table.
You got a lot of stuff?
Yeah.
That's
yeah,
wonderful.
Yeah.
And your family
family's
is
home
all back home.
Yeah, it's pretty nice. It's pretty nice.
You want to feel old, folks. I used to call Michael every Thursday night, you know, to discuss the show.
Yeah.
And often his daughter Mary would answer the phone.
Yeah.
And at the time she was either in junior high school or in high school. I think she was a cheerleader in high school from what I remember. Now Mary has how many kids of her own?
Well, she's like mom and dad. She's got five.
Wow. So
and she's home.
All 15.
Whether brothers.
15 grandchildren.
That's
God
not,
bless
not
you.
Enough.
Well, tell your kids. Don't look at me. Tell your kids.
It's good.
All right. Been more than a quarter of a century since we started.
Yeah.
What are the biggest changes in racing been over that time?
Well, you know, it's really interesting that you would bring that up. And in particular, I'm concerned mostly with Saratoga, which is home, you know. But I guess a change in racing, you know, in general would be, you know, we seem to be so concentrated on the gambling aspect of the game. I'm very worried as a racing fan about so many tracks continuing to decline and people on track. I'm a little worried about on the national scene the groups who think that racing is a cruel sport, and they seem to be getting more and more time on the air. We continue to retire horses too early.
Oh,
you know, it's really, really a shame. I mean, how can you not think of it when you showed American Pharoah in the last segment and what he could have done?
Yeah.
You know, we saw Slough do it after
That's
his
right.
Triple Crown.
That's right.
But, you know, I think racing itself is in good hands with the horsemen and most of the management. But I'm worried about, you know, where we'll be 20 years from now in the national picture and the scheme of things. Thankfully, we've got the Breeders' Cup and the Triple Crown to sustain us in Saratoga in summer. You know,
of course, the Breeders' Cup, particularly this year, had a dramatic impact on the fall races. Many of our stars bypassed that final major prep that we're used to seeing.
Yeah.
Michael, I did a study on this year's Breeders' Cup. There were 31 horses, 31 whose last race was prior to the middle of September. I mean, that never used to be the way it was.
And put it in perspective, in the Breeders' Cup era, what you're saying is true, but even before that, there was this business of laying off long periods of time before major races. If you talk to older trainers about that, they simply do not understand it. So I don't know, I have an answer as to whether or not they are less sound than they were 50 years ago. But for heaven's sakes, we almost deprive fans of the opportunity to see horses that they love. And I mean, it has rendered maybe all of the great races in fall meaningless. And you know, I guess if you're looking for the Eclipse Award, maybe you'd try to aim for that day. But for heaven's sakes, to ignore great horse races, it's a backstretch topic. There's no question about it.
I said in the first segment, in talking about Chad Brown, the incredible rise to the top of his profession. I mean, we're not two-year-olds anymore. We've been around a long time. Is this an unprecedented climb? He hasn't been on his own for that long.
Well, I think unprecedented in terms of someone this young doing it. I think we can say that once Lucas hit the national scene, he rose pretty rapidly. I think we can say that for Todd, Billy maybe for a lesser degree. But I think the thing that is very impressive about Chad is what he's accomplished at such a tender age. Okay, I mean, you know, when you and I were growing up in that other world, you know, you might be hitting your peak at 50 in this ballgame.
Yeah.
Because seemingly it took you that long to learn all the fundamentals.
That's right.
You know, when you graduate from the school of Bobby Frankel, you've got some fundamentals down, okay? And it's a question now of how you do it on your own.
Right.
It doesn't matter what the surface, what the condition, where it is. He gets them ready to run their best race, and a lot of it happens out of the Oklahoma at Saratoga, which is pretty nice.
Certainly.
You know.
And the list of prestigious owners that he has in a short period of time.
We've talked about that.
I mean,
you know, even when we, you know, even the years we weren't on the show together, I mean, people want to give their horses to Chad, and it's pretty incredible. It really is. You know, which goes to another topic we were going to discuss, the era of the mega trainer, you know, as far as a change in thoroughbred racing. But you can't say no, and they know that they're going to get a product from Chad that's ready to go at any level. So I understand. And, you know, if you're going to make a long-term commitment, Chad's on the young side.
Yeah. We have, as I mentioned in the first segment, we had all the NIRA presidents on, starting with Jerry McEwen when we went on the air.
Yeah.
By all accounts, Saratoga has been thriving. But I've known you for a long time, and when I look at you and we talk about Saratoga, you have concerns.
I have a lot of concerns. You know, I have some major concerns. You know, there's a feeling that Saratoga can carry the industry because of the health and the strength of the numbers. No one track can carry the industry. I'm concerned about the eventual apparent loss of Aqueduct and the stress it's going to put on Belmont and Saratoga to conduct more racing. As far as some purely local things, the community has some concerns and some dissension about these late post times on the weekends. It seems like the old relationship between the track and the community have been shredded somewhat, particularly on weekend post times that go to 7 o'clock, and there does not seem to be satisfactory communication on that. I think it's inevitable that Saratoga is going to have a longer meet, and I'll state unequivocally on this show with you or anybody, I don't think that's the right direction to go. But if you kind of look at the landscape and do the math and look at the inevitability of it, I think eventually it's going to happen, and I'm not sure that's the right way to go.
19 years together. What do you remember most about those 19 years?
I think our interviews more than anything else. The joy of having trainers talk to us live, and that it would be, you know, live unrehearsed television, and some of the really good things that happened as far as that goes.
Yeah.
But I think I would just remember the fact that, you know, we came to the studio and you were going to have a well-paced hour or 90 minutes, which you, you know, constructed, and we would get the chance to have longer than normal interviews with trainers.
Yeah.
I'm convinced, as I said the last time that we talked about it, you know, that you and I had the opportunity to deliver to fans not your normal newspaper interview. To get a trainer for 5 or 10 minutes is a very important thing.
One of the most popular features over those 19 years from early January through the end of April were the pedigree profiles. The audience loved those.
Yeah.
And you love doing them.
I love doing them. If your other question was, what do I miss about the show, it would be the 3 hours of pacing together pedigree profile.
Yeah.
Because I think through the show, I learned how much people enjoy learning about the family history, and to have the opportunity to go into depth upon 3, 4, 5, 6 generations of mares, and not only what they did, but who they beat and who their daughters beat. You know, I've never forgotten an amazing comment that someone made. One of my trips to Kentucky, I was at a breeding farm. I think it was Gainesboro, I'm not sure. And I hope, Mr. Williamson, I've not forgotten your name, but he was a stallion manager. And for some reason in the year 2004, he was aware of the pedigree profiles. Well, he wasn't watching us, okay? And I remember saying to him, you know, do you think I'm kind of like off the deep end about going 7 or 8 generations? And he said, Michael, he said, you know, why do you think the Aga Khan keeps the same family for 200 years?
Yeah. You know?
And he said, a gene is like a laser beam that can switch on at any time. And that was the most piercing quote about, yeah, pedigree matters.
Well, I can tell you, folks, from a producer's standpoint, anytime I asked Michael to do something, I knew that it was going to be done to the best of his abilities because of his work ethic. And as a producer, you can't ask for anything more than that. It makes your job so easy. So it was, you know, listen, I wanted you to do more and more and more. And you did a terrific job.
Oh, thank you.
I want to go back and show the audience. This was fun. It happened on the show before Christmas 1 year.
Okay.
We didn't talk about a lot of allowance winners because we didn't have time. I mean, you're talking about stakes horses. You're interviewing guys, you know, at the very top level. But this, I thought, might be a little bit special, and it turned out to be a Christmas present for all racing fans. Let's take a look.
Now, I wanted to show you this allowance race from last Saturday at Hollywood. In fact, it was 3 races before the Hollywood Starlet. an entry-level allowance, non-winners of a race other than for fillies and mares at a mile and a 16th. Watch the outside filly, number 7, Zenyatta. Oh, she broke slowly. This is only her second career start. In her debut sprinting at 6.5 furlongs, she came from well back to rally powerfully and win going away by 3 lengths. But folks, I've been watching races for decades and decades, and I gotta tell you, so often when a horse wins as a deep closer in a sprint, the first time they stretch out to a route, you can't find them. Well, you're gonna be able to find Zenyatta. At the top of your screen, she's last. And take a look at David Flores. He's sitting on her. David's going to sit and sit and sit and sit. This is Pat Day impersonation.
Listen.
And when he turns her loose, watch what happens. Now, I know it's only an entry-level allowance, and she's not racing against anything. But this was so impressive to me. This is a special filly, and here she goes. Watch her gobble up ground.
Oh, yeah.
And David's not even moving his hands.
Wonderful.
Now, she's still as green as grass, folks. You know, watch her in the run through the lane. But partner, even though they didn't pay much money for her, she's got some pedigree, doesn't she?
She's got some pedigree. She's a half to balance the Grade 1 winner who we saw a couple of years ago.
And take a look at this.
At least the Las Virgenes, as a matter of fact. Mark is very excited here, but nonetheless, I'm excited that the guy that I call the Zen Master has Zenyatta up here and just winning geared down. It's wonderful training. It was a wonderful. In fact, I might say that they were all racing. She was still breezing. She must have thought that it was the wrong time of the day because she didn't do anything here, and she won very handily. And Mark will have some information, having had our Julie speak with John this morning about this girl's immediate future.
Well, what'd you think? That's the first time you've seen it.
I'd go straight Grade 1, but
I mean, folks, that was really something special. She is owned by Mr. and Mrs. Jerry Moss, who had Giacomo, who had, you know, one of my partner's favorites in Tiago. Remember him? He got to within
You'll remember him next year.
5.5
That's
lengths.
That's our cigar bet next year.
Of rags to riches in the Belmont Stakes. You remember him very well?
Yeah.
This is a filly with a bright future. And we had Julie call John this morning. As Michael said, he's the Zen Master. John doesn't get terribly excited over very much.
Terrific.
He's excited about this filly. She came out of the race very well. She will run back in the El Encino on Sunday, January 13th at Santa Anita. It's a mile and a 16th stakes. I believe for straight four-year-old fillies.
I'll bet you're right.
I'm almost certain
about
that. Now, how could a half-sister to a multiple graded stakes winner like Balance only cost $60,000? So I asked Julie to ask John, I mean, was she crooked? Is there, you know, something wrong with her? And John loves to joke. He said to Julie, "Oh, my God, Crow, what are you asking me that for?" Apparently, they got her just before Balance started getting good. She had a skin disease.
Okay.
And I guess a rather bad skin disease.
Visible, that's a
which saved the Mosses some money.
Absolutely,
So, do you think she's worth a few dollars more than the $60,000 purchase price?
She's worth 100 times more than the $60,000 they paid
so
for.
So, if you want to create a Santa Anita watch list, you know, just make sure you're not like me and you pay attention. El Encino, Sunday, January 13th, Zenyatta. Was that worth taking a look at?
No, it was. That was good to see.
That was
big
time stuff.
Just love to see a wonderful horse and beautifully prepared.
That's so much fun to latch onto somebody early in their career.
Oh, it is.
That's second career start.
That's right.
And then watch her become one of the all-time greats.
And how lucky was she that she had John Sheriff as a trainer? And what was it about him and great big fillies, Manistique?
You know?
The big dark filly from California. So,
well, you mentioned when I asked you about the remembrances over the 19 years, about the interviews. Talk to the audience about, you know, some of the special interviews that you did.
Well, you know, if I had another hour, we had 25 more names. So, folks, understand we had to.
you know, shorten this up. But I picked four names in no particular order, but I will always remember Neil Howard, his really good sense of humor on the interviews he did on the road to the Derby, and he was always at fairgrounds in the wintertime, and he always took our calls, and the way he described things, and then always managed to end something with a flip quote to either Mark or I. Shug McGahee, what can you say? I enjoyed every visit I ever made to his barn in person. I enjoyed everything that he said on this particular show. And I don't think you're going to find a horseman with as many fascinating insights into the whole game as Shug has. And if you take the time, you know, at some point to look at the way Shug places his horses over the years, and we understand that it's the Phippses, but, you know, a lot of folks in that situation still might not use his rational way of thought. He simply has it. He was a delight to have on the show. All of you, thank you for that. Jimmy Bond, local fella, Saratoga Springs. I don't think you're going to meet a more optimistic person. Tons of fun to have on the show in person. Always willing to give us time. And over the years, he won a couple of Travers and a couple of Whitneys with horses that we did interviews with. Rick Violet completes my quartet. Folks, I don't know how to say this to you about a fellow. You know, if you train horses, if you have maybe five horses to train, you've got enough on your plate for the rest of your life. He trains a full barn of 25 or 30, and he involves himself in politics, in horse racing matters, in management matters. He sits on the board now. And I'd have to say that Rick was a fellow that, in addition to a great interview with us and you know, ask him a question about the horse and the placement, you get a straight answer. But the enormity and the diversity of his career on the backstretch, I don't know how he finds time to do it. He's a very special, very intelligent individual. And that's my quartet, but as you know, could be 10 times more.
Well, of course.
But they stand out in my memory.
You know, Rick joined us this past summer on the final show from Saratoga. We did speak about Diversify at the beginning of the interview, which it turned out to be fabulous. But the great majority of the interview was, and Rick was the person, as you know, who could answer all these questions, the future of racing in New York. Yeah. And he does not see the future of Aqueduct as being much longer.
No.
Aqueduct will not likely be there much longer. And the other, the really somewhat stunning thing he had to say was that he expects during that one or two summers that Belmont is under construction, that the Saratoga meet will expand dramatically. Not just a minor expansion.
Oh, I understand. It's inevitable. You can feel it when you're out there. You can feel it when you're out there. And, you know, you pay attention to the things that he says, but he's really dialed in. And I'm glad he said what he said about Aqueduct. It's a tragedy to lose a great, great major racetrack. Mm-hmm. This is just wrong.
You know, folks, supposedly I was the handicapper of the two of us. You know, I had a pretty good career handicapping for the Schenectady Gazette and the Post Star at Saratoga. But that really wasn't the case coming into the 2004 Belmont Stakes. I didn't think they could realistically beat Smarty Jones, even though I expected him to possibly take a little step back. But my partner had other ideas. Let's take a look. How many legitimate racehorses do we have in here with a legitimate chance to you know, to give Smarty a run?
I don't know if there's anyone with a legitimate chance, Mark. I mean, I'm going to try. I don't take them at 2-5, as you know that. You're a terrific handicapper, and the odds are that maybe he will regress a bit. He can regress a bit and still win this, but I don't know that he doesn't have another great run in him, but I'm going to try to beat him.
All right, who are you going to try to beat
him
with?
Well, I'm going to take a horse who actually has received less attention than both Cayman and Tap Dancer. I'm going to take Birdstone for a shocker today, and here are my reasons why. The Derby is a toss-out, as well as it was for a lot of horses, I believe. I have very strong feelings. I'll say them stronger than I did the week after the lanes. I think I had a terrible ride in the lanes end. I can forgive those two. He's the only other Grade 1 winner in the race. He's back home at Belmont Park.
Nicky does not have to do this. Nick is not a risk taker. There's no pressure. He is due to win his first Belmont. And I'm going to take, hopefully, Birdstone to wake up at a shocker back home in the confines of Belmont Park and maybe deliver a stunning blow today.
Nice selection.
Thank you. They should have shown the look on your face when I pulled my name on that.
Before we let you go,
yeah.
I want to talk to you about the recent, some of the numbers, staggering numbers, from the recent Keeneland November bloodstock sale. And in particular, the broodmare prospects. Songbird, $9.5 million. Teppan, $8 million. Stellar Wind, $6 million. Why this kind of money? Because, listen, I remember this. You and I talked numerous times on this show about there isn't necessarily a correlation between a great race mare and a great brood mare. So people are spending.
I agree.
I mean, it's $23.5 million for just those three. What's going on?
Well, I agree. There's not always a correlation. Some of them do quite well that did well on the track. But I would say this, and this is from someone who's not nearly as watching the markets as I did when I was with Mark on the show, but there are a handful of greats out there. She's one of them. If you saw her at Saratoga, that's all you need to know. If you follow the math of the reducing full crop market, the continued decline in that, okay? And if you follow the most amazing thing, that even with the decline in the market, and the trouble tracks are having, you see this too. Purses are still inching up, which is very interesting. So if you're going to take a risk, if any one of these babies comes out of these mares and looks very good and does well at the sales, it won't take too long to get that $9 million back. But I happen to be with you. It's the risk reward thing there is so enormous.
Wow.
But there is some health left in the game.
Oh, yes.
You know, as far as on the breeding side.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Okay. Your last chance.
Oh.
The audience wants to know, and I'm not sure about the statute of limitations.
My last chance.
The audience wants to know what it was like putting up with me for 19 years.
Creative tension. It was wonderful.
They were fun years.
Yeah, the talks on Thursday night setting up the show was terrific. And the things that we did together were fantastic.
Yeah, they were fun years.
You know, I was kidding.
and thank you for coming back this morning. You made this show very special.
Not at all. No.
Thank you.
Thanks for the invitation.
Good seeing you.
Same here.
I'm so pleased to hear that your family's doing well.
Family's home.
Everything's good. We're not kids any longer. How much longer do you think you want to work?
I haven't thought about it yet.
Okay.
Haven't thought about it. Still going well.
Well, you'll know when it's time.
Yeah.
Good seeing you.
Yeah, same here.
Mike Veach, ladies and gentlemen, we are up to our next break. When we return, Julie Hoxie will join us. As we go to this break, I'm going to show Michael's favorite Seattle Slough. Now, there were all kinds of Seattle Slough races I could show, but I've told you numerous times on this show that the really special races are when a horse gets beat, yet they gain tremendous respect. It happened with Zenyatta in her only career defeat against Blame. But people came out of that classic thinking, my God, is she special. That's exactly what happened to Seattle Slough coming out of the 1978 Jockey Club Gold Cup.
Yeah.
So we'll take a look at the Gold Cup to the break. Back with Julie Hoxie right after these messages.
Good pick.
Mark, I just want to wish you a lot of luck in your retirement. I want to let you know that out of all the interviews I've done since I've been training horses over the last 10 years, I've never worked with anyone more professional, knowledgeable, organized, passionate about what they do, and I'm really going to miss working with you, and I hope to see you around my stables.
All in again. We wait for that start. And the rock for the lead. Seattle Slough along the inside. inside, then affirmed on the outside. It's Life's Hope. Those three go out on the pace together. Then it's a gap of six lengths back, one cut above, followed by Exceller, and finally Great Contractor. They move into the term, a three-horse team. Seattle Slew along the rail, affirmed on the outside second, and Life's Hope on the extreme outside is third, as they move right together on the turn. Then it's a gap of 14 lengths back to one cut above, another six lengths to Exceller, and the trailer is Great Contractor. They whip through that first quarter in 22 and 3. They move still as a team to the back stretch. Seattle Slew along the rail, affirmed on the outside, and Life's Hope further out in third. Those three are really blazing down the back stretch. Then it's a gap of 20 lengths to one cut above. Exceller now moves up to take over that spot. Then the trailer is still Great Contractor. They went a half in 45 and one. The pace is very fast. Down the back stretch, it's Seattle Slew now one length. Firm to second by two, and Life's Hope has now dropped back into third. Then there's a gap of 12 lengths to Exceller, followed by one cut above, and finally Great Contractor. Three quarters of a mile went in a very unbelievable 109 and two. On the turn, still Slew, and he's got it 2.5. Affirmed is picking up a bit of ground on the turn. Then it's a gap of five, and here comes Exceller. He's got it in gear, and he's flying now at the leader. Further back, one cut above. They come for the head of the stretch. Slew still 2.5. Here comes Exceller to the inside. Shoemaker makes his move at Seattle Slew. It is Seattle Slew, Exceller along the inside, those two heads apart. But it's Exceller who has a head in front at the head of the stretch. They went a mile and a quarter in 2:01 and 4, and they're battling it out. Still Slew hanging in there. Exceller has the inside. It's Exceller along the inside. Seattle Slew on the outside. This is a real battle onto the wire, but Exceller gets a narrow lead as they pass the 16th pole. Seattle Slew coming back again. At the finish, this is going to be tight. I see Exceller winning it. It's Seattle Slew second. Great Contractor very far back in third.
TV Television Network. A service of Capital District Off-Track Betting.
Come on!
I want sales reports on my desk by Monday.
Whoops. My bad.
Love racing? RTN brings you every live simulcast on your home television, plus live video streaming and race replays on your PC and mobile devices. To order, visit RTN.tv. RTN, a breed apart.
Here in upstate New York, no one provides bettors with more wagering options than Capital OTB. Our network of branch and easy bet locations stretches from the mid-Hudson Valley all the way to the Canadian border and west to central New York. So whether you need to place a bet, fund your Capital Bets account, or watch the next big race, all the action is just around the corner. A full list of our branch and easy bet locations can be found online at CapitalOTB.com. Capital OTB, the better and most convenient choice for wagering in upstate New York.
Welcome back to Down the Stretch, everyone. I'm Mark Cusano. My thanks to Mike Veach once again for having joined us. Our next guest joined Down the Stretch sometime in 1994 as an intern, and has done a wonderful job ever since. I'm very pleased to welcome in our associate producer, Julie Hoxie. Good morning.
Good morning, Mark.
How are you?
I'm great.
Everything good?
Everything is good. A little nervous, but it's good.
Forget nervous. You're talking to me. How'd you get the job?
Well, I had seen some round penning in a demonstration at SUNY at Cobleskill.
Okay.
And round penning is when someone stands in the middle of a circle and makes physical cues to horses, and they respond and do different things.
Right.
And I said, I need to take that course. So I did, and one course led to another, and I already had a college degree, so all of my credits transferred. And as part of their program at SUNY at Cobleskill, you have to do an internship. So I was a tremendous fan of the show, you and Mike, and I wrote you a letter and said I'm a student, a mature student, and I would like to do my internship with the show.
I can, folks, this is true. I can remember saying to my wife, I've got to go upstairs and call this girl. I mean, it said college students. I have to call this girl because, you know, she'd like to do an internship on the show. That I can remember. If I go to the supermarket without a list, it's even money. I'm going to forget something. But this I can remember from 1994. Something that most people don't know about you. You had your trainer's license for a number of years and enjoyed success at Saratoga. Tell us about that.
I trained a really nice horse, Madame Blum, who won twice at Saratoga.
And we've got a shot of one of those. Filiberto Leone rode for you 1 year,
yep.
And Shane Sellers rode for you another year. What was it like winning races at Saratoga?
Oh, fantastic. Definitely fantastic.
That was very, very exciting. You and your fiancé, Stuart, still have numerous horses on the farm. How many do you tend to?
We have seven.
Still got seven horses.
Mm-hmm.
Couple of dogs, couple
two
of cats.
Two dogs, two cats, yes.
God bless you. I love animals, but you're at another level.
It's busy.
Job description. Tell the audience your major roles as associate producer.
Well, it's changed a little bit over time, but as we became more and more guest-driven, or the guests took up more of the show, I'm in charge of getting the guests, and sometimes that takes a very long time, and other times it's fortunate that it doesn't. And I was talking with someone yesterday, and they said, well, asking me something about the nature of the job, and I said, well, you know, I always call people the first time, a first-time guest. I would always call them. Nowadays we do a lot of texting, but I always want to have that personal contact first, and you never know when people are going to call you back. And in days past, before texting, you never knew when people were going to call you back, so you're kind of always on call. But I loved it. It was always my job that I loved.
That's wonderful, because I've told you folks over the years, if you've been a regular viewer, I've got the easy job. I say, Julie, here's who I'd like. She has to go get them, fit them into their schedule and our schedule, and that's not an easy thing to do. You know, Michael talked about four guests, and he said if we had more time, he could talk about 104. You've got a few that you remember being particularly enjoyable to work with. Fortunately, the great majority of the guests we've had on have been polite and very professional. But the first one you want to discuss maybe takes politeness to another degree. Who's that?
Graham Motion. He gets my nomination for the Good Guy Award because Graham is always pleasant. He's always polite. He is happy to come on our show. He's articulate.
Yes.
I used to say I wish my daughter would marry him. That's how much I like him.
That's wonderful. Art Sherman got his big horse late in life, and he's been a lot of fun.
Art Sherman is very charming. He is. He's a ladies' man. He said more than once, oh, I wish you were here. We're having cocktails at Del Mar. And I think he had a small group of women that supposedly cherished California Chrome, but I think they liked Art, really.
Yes, as well.
And Art, you know, what a wonderful story for him. You know, the biggest horse he's ever had. And he loved that horse.
Oh,
always
God.
So confident in the horse. And even though he had problems with ownership issues, I think he really, it was the time of his life.
Yeah, without question. Michael and I touched upon this during his segment, the Zen Master.
John Sheriffs, well, it was one of the most touching conversations I had with someone. It was after Giacomo won the Kentucky Derby. And John, in the first few years that we had him on, was much more quiet than he is today. Yep. He's a very shy man. He's become less so, but I think I had called him and he said, can you call me back in 10 minutes? And I said, sure. And I called him back and he said, I'm just leaving the racing office and I have in my hands Giacomo's full certificate, and on the back it says that he won the Kentucky Derby. God. And he was it was so heartfelt, and it was such a moment that I felt like I participated in. It was really special.
In 2003, the late Bobby Frankel set a then record by winning 25 Grade One races in a calendar year. That meant we were calling him often. What was that like?
Bobby Frankel would probably get the prize for the person that I dreaded calling the most, because he was always grouchy with me. Very, very grouchy. I think he might say something like, you again. But it was my job, so I would persevere. But the surprising part was, when he was on the air and he talked to you, he was always very pleasant.
Absolutely.
I'd say, Mark, he loves you.
And Bobby did, toward the end of his career, Bobby did one of the lengthiest live interviews at Saratoga that we've ever done. So while he could be gruff at times, he was also very generous with his time. And yes. we always appreciated that. I wanted Nick Zito on badly, Travers Day 2004, because I not only liked Birdstone for the Travers very much, but Nick was doing something quite different. He was bringing Birdstone up to the Travers off a lengthy layoff, not having raced since the Belmont. And that was unusual in those days. But that was tricky to get Nick on that week. How come?
It was often tricky to get Nick on, and oftentimes I'd have to go through his assistant, Tim. And I think in this particular situation, I think I enlisted his wife's help to get Nick on, because Tim would say, I asked Nick, and he just wouldn't answer me. So I'm not sure what to tell you, Julie. So it was difficult, but... Well, when we got him on.
You know, folks, he told us that week, I'm so busy. It's really next to impossible for me to do it. So, Julie, you have to tell Mark, if I come over there, he's got to get me out of there quickly. And we promised him, just tell us what time you got to get out of here, and I'll make sure I get you off. What do you think happened? He came, he sat, and he wouldn't leave. Let's take a look at a piece of that interview.
This is a fun story. I wish I had a little more time to tell you, but Nick Zito all week long said, oh, Mark, I'm so busy. He said, I can do it if you get me in there and get me out of there real quick. I don't have an awful lot of time. So, of course, Nick got here nice and early, started to relax, did the interview, and he just wanted to stick around. He was having so much fun. Later this afternoon, I hope he has some fun, because he's going to saddle three of them for the Travers in Sir Shackleton, the Cliff's Edge, and Birdstone. And ladies and gentlemen, our final guest this morning is trainer Nick Zito.
I think it would be important to tell our audience why he hasn't run since the Belmont Stakes.
Sure, and it's a legitimate question. Birdstone, as you know by now, and it's interesting, because I'll stay on the same subject, Patrick Bing Cohn said, my God, what did you do to this horse? He looks like a monster. And if you look at Birdstone, he's still small and whatever, but the time has really helped him. You know, he's got some good muscle on him now, and he's not a very big horse. And if you look at all his races, for the fans out there, if they just look at the chart, look at the form of the races, he certainly runs better when he has time in between. That obviously is because of his size. you know, we call him little man around the racetrack, but I'll tell you what, he may be little man, but he's probably got the biggest heart. So that's basically why we did this.
One final question on Birdstone. I want you to quantify something for the audience.
Yeah.
On a scale of 0 to 10, 10 being as good as you could have him, as good as he could be doing health-wise,
yeah.
What's his number heading into this afternoon's Travers?
Whether I'm right or wrong, people know I'm honest, right?
I know that.
I'd say 11 and a half.
I know that.
That's what I'd say, 11 and a half. So that's all I can say.
Yeah. Okay.
You know, whatever, whether I lose or not, I mean, listen, you got to go around. You know, Smarty Jones was 1 to 1 million, and he lost. I mean, but this horse couldn't be any better.
Okay. My favorite answers to any question I ever asked. You know, he quantified it. That's how great Birdstone was doing. But he would never leave. You got to get me out of there quickly, and would never leave. One of the favorites of the audience was the Cajun, Eric Guillot. I know what it was like to interview him. What was he like behind the scenes? He was a pretty friendly guy.
Eric is definitely a friendly guy. He certainly is a character. I think the first time we ever had him on was going to be at Saratoga Live. And I always remind the guests the night before, and I remind them earlier the morning of. I'm on my way to the track, and I pull over in Ballston Spa to call Eric, and he said, yeah, I'll be there, and my owner and his daughter, and I want them to come on with me. And while this sounds like a small request,
yeah.
Oh, I don't know what Mark will say about this. Eric, I'm going to have to check with our producer, and I will get right back to you, Mark said. What? A little girl and an owner? I don't know if we have the room, the seats, and the mics, but it all worked out.
She sat on her dad's lap, and she was wonderful.
Yeah.
And Eric, listen, we had a great time. The only thing is, I needed an interpreter. I mean, I wasn't sure what he was saying.
It can be difficult.
You know, one time we were talking about one of his horses, and he started talking about he was traveling like a three-legged donkey, and I had no idea what he was talking about. But he was successful, and he was very generous with his time, and we always appreciated that. One of the great examples of what kind of pressure these folks are under came with Charlie Lopresti when he was training Wise Dan. And Charlie was a very nice man, but he'd admit it, the pressure got to him. It was tough.
Yes, we had him on many times. I'm not sure exactly when this was and what was going on behind the scenes, but he said, why are you calling me again? This kind of thing. And I said, well, Charlie, you know, the story's important and we want to have you on to talk about Wise Dan. And 20 minutes later, my phone rang again and it was Charlie apologizing for being gruff. And
that can happen.
Subsequently, Charlie was on with us at Saratoga. I think he was on with us 2 years, but
yeah.
I had picked him up in the golf cart to come over, and when I dropped him off, I said, is it possible for me to see Wise Dan? And he said, sure, follow me. You know, we'll go over and see what he's doing. And Wise Dan ran to the front of the stall, and I'm very familiar with working around horses, and he stuck his head out and, well, we say, kiss. He put his nose right on my face. I didn't know if he was going to bite me or, and I was like, oh, I was kissed by Wise Dan.
Well,
I'll never wash my face
again. That's right. You know, we like to run on time. It's critical because we know how busy our guests are. So it's critical to get to them, you know, as closely to the time we tell them. Every summer at Saratoga, in the years where we could tape interviews, and you saw the taped interview with Nick Zito a few moments ago, we would tape Todd Pletcher every year at Saratoga.
And just like every other guest, we give them a 5-minute window. You know, be there between 11:40 and 11:45. What did Todd say to you?
Could you give me an exact time? And Todd was there at that exact time. He's a very precise person, nice person.
He's not only a precise person, he's got a wonderfully dry sense of humor. And we obviously always enjoyed interviewing Todd. Do you remember the most guests we've ever had on one show?
Well, it must have been when we had a longer show.
Yeah, 90
and
minutes.
And it was probably a pre-Breeders' Cup show.
It was.
But no, I don't.
7 guests. You organized 7 guests in a 90-minute show. That's not easy to do. All right. Finally, and this goes back to pressure, and this is going to come as a surprise to some of you, particularly if you've been watching recently. I finished interviewing a guest at Saratoga, and he said, I'd rather go to the dentist than do these kinds of interviews. Who was that?
Steve Asmussen.
Now, folks, that was the morning of the Whitney. So to show you how much pressure he was under, that came on Whitney morning. Last week, when we called him to be on the show, it was the best interview I've ever done with Steve Asmussen. Now, Julie, I didn't take it personally when he said that. Like, I was the only one, he'd rather go to the dentist. But that gives an idea how much pressure these guys are under.
They definitely are under pressure, but I think our show has helped many trainers. And I said to Steve, now you're all set to talk to NBC.
That's right.
And afterwards, I did text Steve and thanked him again. And I said, you know, these interviews are really great for the sport. And I like to think maybe that's why he had a better attitude when he came back on.
Julie, it's been fun. Congratulations, 23 plus years. You've done a wonderful job. We could not have done it without you. It's been a lot of fun working with you.
Well, it's been a pleasure.
All the best.
And I will be very sad and miss it.
Well, congratulations again.
Thank you.
Julie Hoxie, ladies and gentlemen, we are up to our next break. When we return, Capital OTB President John Signor will join us. Now, as we go to this break, more history in the 2007 Belmont Stakes. Rags to Riches was an 11th hour entrant from Todd Pletcher. And we talked about how, you know, organized Todd is. This was an unusual situation for Todd. Things didn't start out so well for Rags to Riches. As we take a look at this great shot from the super talented Barbara Livingston at the start of the 2007 Belmont, where Rags to Riches went to her nose. So we will take a look at the 2007 Belmont Stakes to the break. Back with John Signor right after these messages.
Enjoy your retirement, Mark. You will be missed. We love your interviews every Saturday morning here at Saratoga and every day for that matter. But I always enjoy doing my interviews with you because you do a great job, do all your homework, and are a great interviewer.
Ready for the start of the 139th Belmont Stakes. And they're off. Oh, and the filly bobbled at the break. Rags to Riches stumbled coming out of there. And C.P. West comes out in stride. Sluice Tizzy is there. And hard spun to their outside. And then farther back, it's Curlin. And Rags to Riches out in the middle of the track there. Then Tiago and I'm a Wild and Crazy Guy. So they make their way for the first turn. And Edgar Prado will keep C.P. West well off the rail. Sluice Tizzy is very eager to get to that lead on the outside. Curlin up close today. Through the opening quarter, there was a tepid 24 and 3/5 seconds. Hard spun is right alongside Curlin. and it's two lengths back, and the filly Rags to Riches is fifth, followed by Tiago at the rail, and seven or eight lengths back to the trailer, I'm a Wild and Crazy Guy who's just lumbering along in the early stages of this mile-and-a-half classic. So they make that turn into the backstretch run. The pace has been sensible the opening quarter mile, and the half was 50 seconds flat. It's just a bit of a crawl here in the early stages of the Belmont, and Slew's Tizzy is the leader. Slew's Tizzy in front, CP West right there. Hard spun up close, hard held while third. On the inside is Curlin, just inside of the filly Rags to Riches. Tiago is only 5.5 lengths from the leaders. 7 lengths back to stretch running, I'm a Wild and Crazy Guy. 3/4 of a mile in 1:15.1. Now the field is approaching the far turn. A long way to go yet. CP West, the riders have been very patient, not making a move. There's 5 furlongs to go. Their position's relatively unchanged. CP West the leader. Slew's Tizzy is second. Hard spun's in a perfect position on the outside. Curlin could get bottled up on the inside. Rags to Riches in the clear fifth, only 3 lengths from the lead. And Tiago is beginning to roll now. He's only 3 lengths from the front. They're midway around the far turn. 5 of them within 4.5 lengths of each other. And the leader is CP West. Nothing left for Slew's Tizzy. Here comes Hardspun. And Curlin is coming on through in between horses. And Rags to Riches is coming with a 4-wide sweep. And Tiago is in behind them. And at the top of the stretch, a filly is in front of the Belmont. But Curlin is right there with her. These two in a battle of the sexes in the Belmont Stakes. It is Curlin on the inside. Rags to Riches on the outside. A desperate finish. Rags to Riches and Curlin. They're coming down to the wire. It's going to be very close. And it's going to be a filly in the Belmont. Rags to Riches has beaten Curlin in 100 years of Belmont history. The first filly to win it in over a century.
This is the OTB Television Network, a service of Capital District Off-Track Betting.
What if there was a way to become a better horse player, to have a better knowledge of the game, to be more successful? What if there were a way to take what you've learned, what you know, and make better decisions, better choices, to know how to connect the dots? In horse racing, knowledge is a powerful tool, but not the only tool. Race results and replays, past performances and live streaming, wagering from all your digital devices. These two are important tools, and you'll find them all right here at Capital OTB. Capital OTB. Become a better horse player.
Welcome back to Down the Stretch, everyone. I'm Mark Cusano. My thanks once again to Julie Hoxie for having joined us. Final guest this morning, the president of Capital OTB, Mr. John Signor. John, welcome
Mark,
to the show.
Thanks a lot.
Good
Appreciate
to see you.
It. Good to see you. Good
you
to
know,
see you.
Earlier I asked Michael, since we went on the air in 92, from his perspective, how has things changed in racing? I got to thinking, from your perspective, the way money is wagered nowadays has changed probably as dramatically as anything in the sport.
Yeah, absolutely.
Talk about that.
Absolutely. Well, I mean, obviously, online betting, account wagering is the single biggest growth area in the industry. Probably in 2004 or five, when online betting started, we were doing maybe $3 million a year on that. Now we're doing $60 million a year.
$60 million.
$60 million a year on account wagering. So that's the big growth area. But with that comes a lot of competition. You know, if you look at OTB and OTB TV, we used to be, for the longest time, we're the only game in town.
Yeah.
And prior to account wagering, it was, you know, Phonabet was
right.
the big, you know,
right.
account wagering. That's
right.
the way people made their bets or went to a branch.
Right.
But with online betting, you know, you can sit there with your phone and be on a beach in, you know, in San Diego and
yeah.
and bet the races. So it has definitely, you know, brought more access to racing. But that's probably the single biggest change. And also, just in terms of horse racing, I think social media has become huge. Twitter, Facebook, that type of, you know, the social media aspects. I think that is growing the industry as well because you're able to communicate so much information, send out pictures from tracks, send out videos from tracks.
Right.
You know, you can send a video out right after the race has been run, you know, to the Breeders' Cup, and people can watch it right on their phone. Yeah. So it's, I think social media and account wagering are probably the two biggest. And from our aspect at Capital ATB, probably competition, right? I mean, we have obviously a new casino that's in the heart of our region in Schenectady. So I think competition has been a big piece of it as well from our vantage point at Capital ATB.
Capital has been the only OTB corporation in the state of New York to have its own 24-hour, 7-day-a-week television station. Yeah. It's obviously meant a great deal to me.
Sure.
What advantage has that given Capital?
I think, you know what? I think it really separates us from the rest of the racing entities in New York State. For the longest time, even NYRA didn't have anything. And then subsequently, they're doing stuff with FS1 and some of the other cable companies. But just to digress a little bit, it was great to see Mike Veach getting the old band back together. You and Mike and Julie, just tremendous work over the years. And a lot of the things you're talking about, you know, I've been here 17 years, so I lived it and saw it, and a lot of the races you're showing and a lot of the shows that you guys did were great. But I think the TV station really separates us. We're able to bring, it's how I became a racing fan through Capital OTB. You know, my transformation was with Easy Goer. I was a big Easy Goer fan, and that turned me into a racing fan, which then turned me on to Capital OTB. Yeah. Capital OTB TV, and I've been a fan ever since. But I think it helps create racing fans with OTB TV. And the big thing I think it does is it helps promote Saratoga. Obviously, being live at Saratoga, on the backstretch, doing those shows, and having live interviews with the leaders in the industry sitting right next to you, in my view, has been huge and has helped promote Saratoga Racetrack, Saratoga Racing. I mean, we do it year round with all the tracks, Aqueduct, Belmont, but I think that's special. And I think, you know, and everybody, I know from your vantage point and everybody else from OTB TV takes a lot of pride in their work up there. It takes a lot of pride all the time, but Saratoga's just a special time. And really, that's when I think we really have done our best work. And I think that's great for the Capital Region. And I think it's helped create racing fans, and that's what we're trying to do.
About 3 years ago, the network went from its coveted spot, TV12. Everybody knew it as TV12. It was a great spot to be on the dial, but it was extraordinarily expensive.
Yes. Yeah.
You went from TV12 to Channel 1250, which was a break in itself, but that's a major change.
Yeah.
Has that impacted things?
It was a major change. Well, a couple things. I think initially it did impact us a little bit. Obviously, Channel 12, we were known as Channel 12, and we were right, you know, between, you know, all the network stations.
Yeah.
We were told by at the time, Time Warner, now it's Spectrum, that we were going to have to go to a digital channel. And fortunately, we were able to work with Channel 10, who owns Fox. And we were able to get a substation of Fox. We're also on 8.2 if you have one of the newer TVs, we're on 8.2. But we went, ironically, the change, we went from 300,000 households in upstate New York to 500,000 households in upstate New York. So we actually increased, by moving to digital, we were able to get in 200,000 more households in upstate New York. So I think the change initially hurt us, but fortunately we were able to bring OTB TV and horse racing into more homes in upstate New York, which I think is at a significantly lower price. So it was a win-win for the corporation and for racing fans in the Capital Region.
With the invention of the internet and smartphones, has television lost some of its importance?
You know, I think from our vantage point, I think the wagering along with our TV station, as I said, back in the day, we're the only game in town. So if you're going to bet through an account, you're going to do it at, you know, Capital OTV through your phone a bet account. Now, you know, we're still providing, you know, the great racing all day, 24/7, the great shows, you know, Saratoga wall-to-wall coverage. But somebody can be sitting there and betting through, you know, a California Express bet account and watching our station. And I think what people have to understand is we are unique here at Capital OTB, and you know, you've really, your shows with Mike and everybody else has really put Capital OTB on the map in terms of programming and things of that nature. But I think people who are watching need to understand that, you know, this isn't, you know, having a TV station isn't free. There's a reason other OTBs and tracks don't have a TV station. It's because it costs money. Yeah. So I'm not going to, you know, we do okay. You know, our business has been fine. I think the casino has impacted us a little bit. But if you enjoy Capital OTB, if you enjoy Capital OTB TV, I think we're competitive on all the fronts in terms of cash rewards and things like that. I would just say, you know, look at Capital OTB, and you might want to consider wagering with us if you appreciate everything that we've brought you and will continue to bring you for years to come. You know, as I said, if you're watching our station 24/7 and you're betting with other entities, that's not, you know, we have to pay the bills. Yeah. So, you know, that's just something people should keep in mind. But the TV station, in my view, is a tremendous asset, and we're going to continue to, you know, do great things with it. And we're very sorry to see you leave. We obviously, you've done a tremendous job for Capital OTB. You've set the gold standard in excellence. The interviews, we always knew Saturday, you know, whether at 9 o'clock or 10 o'clock. We were going to have a show that was you know, great analysis, great handicapping, terrific interviews with the leaders in the industry. Mm-hmm. And it was just week in, week out, that's what happened. And we couldn't be more proud of the show that you put on and proud that you were here for 25 years and did tremendous work.
Thank you. I appreciate that. One final question. The Breeders' Cup has basically been, you know, situated on the West Coast now for a number of years. And that means very late post times here in the East. And wagering has a tendency to drop off as you get later. As soon as NYRA gets approval, which they expect to get, they're going to likely experiment with some night racing during the summer at Belmont.
Yeah.
Now, they're very excited about that. Are you excited about it from a wagering standpoint?
Yeah, it's you know, a lot of the tracks have done it. Churchill does Thursday after dark. I think they do some racing even on Saturdays at 6 p.m. sometimes. I think it's something that NYRA should try. I'm not averse to it. I know they need legislation to do it.
Yes.
So it's something that still needs to go through the legislative process in order for them to do it. I personally think OTB's stance is we're not against it.
Okay.
And we're working, you know, we've had conversations with NYRA on that front. But I think it's something that, look, if you can bring a different crowd in at night that maybe you wouldn't get during the day,
right.
I don't see it as a problem. I think it's worth trying and experimenting that way. So I'm totally, you know, I think it's worth trying.
Well, I want to thank you for joining us this morning. And I want to thank you for your support of the show. You know, we've always appreciated that. And it's good seeing you.
Yeah, you too. I got a couple things here, right? Well, number one, you usually give these out, right? But this is a gift card to 15 Church, our buddy Paul McCullough at 15 Church for bringing the wife and yourself
for
dinner. So,
well, thank you, because, you know, I won't have an income here, so I'll need all the free food I can get.
Thank you.
That's very nice.
And I just wanted to tell you, we talked about it, and again, we appreciate the 25 years you've given us. And we're going to clean the studio up. But we're gonna put a plaque up on the studio, the Mark Cusano Studio here at Capital OTB.
That's very nice.
In honor of what you know, I've always believed that the programming we've done deserves recognition in terms of like Eclipse Awards and things like that. I honestly believe that. You know, they'll give somebody an Eclipse for a 30-minute program. You do it an hour every week for 52 weeks. So I wanted to do something to recognize what I think is great, you know, TV that we've been putting out, you know, back in the day, Tom and Nick and everybody who's on the station.
Yeah.
But in particular, as I said, I think you really set the gold standard at Capital OTB in terms of programming, professionalism, and educating, you know, racing fans out there. And you know, all my friends are racing fans, and they are big fans of the show. And so we're gonna the studio will be named the Mark Cusano Studio. So I just
I can't get emotional because I will never be able to finish this show. But thank you. That's
and we have
meaningful.
A few more and we have a few more parting gifts when you go. But
thank
I,
you.
I appreciate everything you've done, Mark. You've
Thanks.
Done a tremendous job. And
thank you.
And and hopefully, and you and I have had discussions. We'd love to have you come back if you're able to, if you want to, in some capacity. Maybe not an hour show, but. Maybe do some interviews or things like that. But that's, you and I will talk about that in the future, and I hope it comes back. It, you know, you're able to do that.
Thank
but
you.
This is your day, and congratulations.
Thank you, and thank you for that. You know, that's wonderful to name the studio. As long as it doesn't say Memorial Studio,
no,
then,
no,
I'm
no,
okay.
no.
then I'm okay. Then I'm all right.
No,
thank
no.
you, John.
All right,
appreciate
thanks,
it. John
appreciate
Singer,
it.
Ladies and gentlemen. We are up to our final break. This is it, and you know, what else would I show going to the final break after 25 and a half years? Jack Nicklaus, the greatest golfer of my lifetime. Yes, young people, he was better than Tiger Woods. Called this perfection. So we're going to take a look at perfection going to the final break. Back to wrap things up right after these messages.
Well, first of all, happy retirement and best wishes to Mark. Always been a very professional, well-rounded, knowledgeable guy that you know is, always did quality interviews and you know is very passionate about the sport and I think a real attribute to racing in general. So we'll all miss him.
For this tremendous Belmont Stakes, everybody's in line and they're off. Looks like the early lead goes to Mike Gallant. Yes, Mike Gallant going for the lead was twice impressed on the outside. Secretariat away very well, has good position on the rail, and in fact is now going up with the leader. They're moving for the first turn. It is Secretariat. Sham on the outside is also moving along strongly. And now it's Sham. Sham and Secretariat are right together into the first turn. Mike Gallant has third behind them. Then it's twice a prince, and the trailer is Private Smiles as they go by the turn. Those two together, Sham on the outside. Sham getting ahead in front as they move around the turn with Secretariat second. Then there's a large gap. Make it eight lengths back to Mike Gallant in third and Vice of Prince fourth. And Private Smiles is still the trailer. They're on the backstretch. It's almost a match race now. Secretariat's on the inside by a head. Sham is on the outside. They've opened 10 lengths on Mike Gallant, who is third by a head, with Vice of Prince fourth. Then it's another eight lengths back to Private Smiles, who is trailing the field. They continue down the backstretch, and that's Secretariat now taking the lead. He's got it by about a length and a half. Still Sham, 10 lengths back, Mike Gallant, Vice of Prince. They're moving on the turn now. For the turn, it's Secretariat. It looks like he's opening. The lead is increasing. Make it three and a half. He's moving into the turn. Secretariat holding on to a large lead. Sham is second, and then it's a long way back to Mike Gallant and Vice of Prince. They're on the turn. It's Secretariat is blazing along the first three quarters of a mile in 109 and 4/5. Secretariat is widening now. He is moving like a tremendous machine. Secretariat by 12. Secretariat by 14 lengths on the turn. Sham is dropping back. It looks like they'll catch him today as Mike Gallant and Vice of Prince are both coming up to him now. But Secretariat is all alone. He's out there almost a 16th of a mile away from the rest of the horses. Secretariat is in a position that seems impossible to catch. He's into the stretch. Secretariat leads his field by 18 lengths. And now Price of Prince is taken second, and Mike Gallant has moved back to third. They're in the stretch. Secretariat has opened a 22-length lead. He is going to be the Triple Crown winner. Here comes Secretariat to the wire. An unbelievable, an amazing performance. He hits the finish 25 lengths in front. It's going to be Price of Prince second, Mike Gallant third, Private Smiles fourth, and Sham, who had it today, got back to fifth.
This is the OTB Television Network, a service of Capital District Off-Track Betting.
Champions don't come easy. It takes hard work, intelligence, and a desire to be the very best. At Bloodlines Racing, we team up with champion racehorses like Invasor, Street Cry, and others. Our second partnership horse, Invading Humor, became a champion turf filly in 2015. We want you to join our team. At Bloodlines Racing, we make ownership easy, utilizing a one-time only payment structure. You pay once, and that's it. We currently are making available three outstanding two-year-olds, one of them a sibling, to Champion Invading Humor. Come join us in the pursuit of our next champion. Details of these partnerships are on our website, Bloodlines Racing. We make ownership fun and easy.
Welcome back to Down the Stretch, everyone. I'm Mark Cusano. My thanks to John Signor once again for having joined us. Hope you enjoyed looking back one last time at perfection. As I mentioned earlier, I've done more than 2,000 interviews on this show. Some I've had to work a bit harder than others, but I can honestly say to you, I've enjoyed every one. I really, really enjoy interviewing people. Which interview was I going to save for last? Because it must be, to a certain degree, the most meaningful interview for me, or the one I enjoyed the most. We're going to go back to the summer of 2009 at Saratoga. A lot was going on that summer. Midway through the meet, Linda Rice was leading the trainer standings. And she was starting far less horses than Todd was, but she was winning at an incredible percentage. So we were in the midst, at least the possibility, of history being made. So I really wanted to get Linda on the show. She was a little bit shy at that time, and a few days earlier had gone through a kind of a bad experience with a mainstream media outlet interviewing her. You know, I'm not being critical, but folks who don't follow racing the rest of the year, and I give them credit for picking up on this, but she was a little bit hesitant to do it, and we convinced her to do it. So considering everything that was on the line, history in the making, and I always remember her facial expressions changing as we did this interview, and she had just a great answer to one of my questions. So we're going to go back to the summer of 2009 at Saratoga and Linda Rice.
What are some of the reasons that go into making this such an extraordinary meet thus far?
Well, for me, I try to bring an abundance of opportunity with me when I come to Saratoga. You need numbers, and I do my best to gather up enough numbers and enter them pretty aggressively. You know, some horses, Tahoe Warrior, for example, things didn't go well 1 week. I ran him back in 5 days because I thought it was the right spot, the right distance, and it turned out great. Sometimes I'll run fillies against colts. I push the envelope a little bit, but and I try to bring enough opportunity with me, make it happen.
Do you have enough horses, fresh horses? Do you have enough ammunition to keep this going for the second half of the meet?
Well, that is my concern. I mean, obviously I'm dealing and competing against great trainers here at Saratoga, the best in the world. And, Todd Pletcher, Karen McLaughlin, Billy Mott, they have a lot of stock standing in their barn. I'm putting it together, but it's not easy. And I hope one day that I'll have the same type of horses standing in my barn.
I said during the intro, sensational and possibly historic meet. No female trainer has ever won the training title at the world's greatest race meet. Do you think about that at all?
No.
Are you thinking about it now?
Not that you put it that way, Mark. Now I'm concerned about it.
I mean, this is big time stuff.
Really is.
Well, this is incredible.
I mean, sure, it's something I've thought about, and unless you get real close to it, I've given it some thought, and it's an excited possibility. But there's a lot of meat left.
I'm so glad Linda agreed to do that interview that day. That was very special. Something else that's extremely special to me. At the end of every show we've ever done, I have read you the names of the folks who helped get that week's show on the air. So I decided that what we were going to do this week is put together a credit roll with every individual who has had something to do with this program over the last 25 and a half years. And I couldn't miss anybody. It's that important to me. So if you've enjoyed the show, and if you're still with us this morning after, you know, an hour and 55 minutes, you're obviously enjoying the show, please sit back and relax and watch as these names roll by, because every one of these individuals had something to do with the success of Down the Stretch. Now, the music we put on the roll. I'm not a huge country music fan, but I really like this song. It's called I Hope You Dance, and it's done by Leanne Womack. The late Maya Angelou, the poet, loved this song so much that she told her family she wanted this song at her services. And Leanne Womack went and did this song live. So please enjoy, settle back. It's going to run for a couple of minutes. Take a look at the names that have helped get this show on the air and enjoy I Hope You Dance. And we'll be back in a few moments.
Oh,
Hope you enjoyed that. And one thank you, one name you didn't see on there, thank you to my wife for having put up with me since secretary, it was a two-year-old, in 1972. Thanks to the folks who helped get this week's show on the air. I got to try to hold it together. Dan Hayes, wonderful job directing these last seven shows. Thank you to Brian Dorenzo, Mick Richards. I like to say Mick graduated the same high school as I did, Linton High School in Schenectady, but he graduated the decade before I did, and this is accurate. He doesn't like this. I graduated in 1970. He graduated in 1969. Mick, thanks so much for editing those pieces, working on the audio of those pieces. Good job. Pat Peretta, our longtime director who's moved on to another department in the company. Pat, thank you. Thanks to our guests. Thanks so much to Mike Veach and Julie Hoxie and John Signor. And thanks to our sponsor, Bloodlines Racing, home of New York bred turf champion Invading Humor and her full sister Distorted Beauty. For information on their current partnerships, visit them on the web at bloodlinesracing.com, or better yet, call Randy McGlynn, 802-436-2159. He'll speak to you about whatever they have available. I want to thank Tim Wilkin of the Albany Times Union. He did a piece on the show in yesterday's TU. Thank you, Tim. Very nice job. And thanks to Tom Law. Now, I don't know if you can go online and get the TU article. You probably have to be a subscriber. But Tom wrote a piece in thisishorseracing.com. You know, Tom, along with the Clancy brothers, do a magnificent job during the Saratoga meet of producing and publishing the Saratoga special. So after the show, if you go to thisishorseracing.com, you can view the piece that Tom did. So thanks, guys. We appreciate it. As I mentioned to you earlier, in 1992, when we started this, I wanted to highlight interviews with the most prominent individuals. And thanks to their tremendous cooperation, we've been able to do that for a quarter century. I think one of my favorite quotes from our guests came from Mark Hennig. Back in the days when he was training the Edward Evans horses, he had Summer Colony, that wonderful mare who, by the way, defeated, and not many did, defeated Azari. And we would be calling Mark on a regular basis because he was doing so well. And he said to us, "I never mind when you call me. I love to hear from you because I know I'm doing something right. You never have any stiffs on your show." That's a quote I will always remember. Thank you to Mark. Thank you to all the guests who have appeared. And thank you so much. So for the final time, from the Mark Cusano studio, from all of us at Down the Stretch, I say goodbye.
You're watching OTB TV, a service of Capital Off-Track Betting.